Good morning and welcome to Sunday morning worship at First Baptist Church Holcomb for October the 9th. Just some announcements for the morning. We are a little over halfway to our Margaret Lackey State Mission Offering. So if you have not given yet to the State Mission Offering, remember that there's a lot of different things that offering goes to. They're listed on your bulletin. Our audiovisual fund, we are about a quarter of the way toward what we need to have to do some upgrades. And we are giving to Operation Christmas Child. And we are always have needs for our food pantry. So those are just some normal things that we will have for us during the month of October. Also remember our normal morning offering. If you are joining us with Facebook Live or on the YouTube recast, you may mail in your offerings to PO Box 205 or bring them by 504 Griffin Avenue. But not tomorrow, because our church office will be closed tomorrow for the Columbus Day observance. October the 16th is our Breast Cancer Awareness Day, and we're asked to wear something pink that Sunday, so we're going to pink out that day. We'll have a business meeting that Sunday night after our evening service. Our Young at Heart will meet on Wednesday, October the 19th, and on October the 23rd will be our regular monthly deacons meeting. We are in the season of our United Prayer Emphasis. This week, our United Prayer Emphasis is for Opelona First Baptist Church. So be in prayer for Opelona First Baptist Church. This week, we will have our our yearly association meeting that will be at 6:30 on Thursday night down at Bethel. We have people that have been elected to serve as messengers. But we would ask you to be in prayer for that gathering. And if you want to come and be a part of it, please feel free to do so. Let's bow this morning for a word of prayer. And then I believe we're going to hear something from Harlan Galloway. So let's pray together. Lord, I ask you to be with us this morning as we gather here to worship you. Lord, we just ask that you just draw our hearts closer to you, and Lord, that we will be followers and servants of yours, Lord, that we will do your will in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. And now, Harlan, if you will come this way.
As most of you know, October is Pastor Appreciation Month. And this is a little token we've got for Brother Patrick and his family. All right. We want you to know that we love you. We appreciate you. Everything you do for our church.
Appreciate it. Love you, brother.
Thank you.
Brother Patrick, do you have any other announcements
you need to make? Sure, I'll go ahead.
Thank you for that, and we do love and appreciate y'all as well and everything you do for us each day and each week. I do want to quickly remind you about our Connect gatherings tonight for men and women. The men will be meeting in the old kitchen, women meeting in the Family Life Center, and for the ladies, you just kind of did an introduction last Sunday night, so if you weren't able to make it last Sunday night and want to come tonight, you didn't miss anything, 5 o'clock, Family Life Center, you have a Bible study going on. The men have a Bible study going on as well. And looking forward to those groups continuing to build and get the momentum going there. And we do have Amanda, who will be here in the nursery, and Hannah Collins has agreed to help out with any kids who are not nursery age and do a little something with them during that time. So you come out at 5 o'clock tonight and then our regular service at 6. All right, Ms. Melinda.
Thank you.
leading the way. And we are going to continue our singing with "We Have Heard the Joyful Sound."
Shelter, tower of rest. Lord, Lord, just speak to him and let you have for us today. Lord, we love you, and we ask forgive us for every way we fail. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Opportunity in Acts chapter 3.
Yeah.
thank you for that, Miss Melinda, and hopefully you've made your way to Acts chapter 3. If not, I'm going to give you just a little bit more time to make it to Acts chapter 3 this morning, as do want to say thank you to the Young at Heart for letting me tag along with them this week on their trip. We went to the Ark Encounter and the Creation Museum in Kentucky. We had a good time, a great time of fellowship. We did plenty of eating, and you may not be able to see this morning, but I did bring back some socks from the Ark. They were handcrafted by Noah's wife. If you believe that it was handcrafted by Noah's wife, I've got some property in Brooklyn, I'll show you later on, okay? But we did have a good time, and was thankful for the opportunity to go and be a part of that. In the Ark, I followed Brother David and Miss Cindy around for most of that time, and I let them know that they could let Timothy know I was his substitute for the day. So it was a good time. We had a real good time, good trip back. A lot of memories made. Patsy has posted some pictures. We'll have some more pictures to put on the church Facebook page documenting some of what we were able to see this week. In Acts chapter 3, in the first 11 verses is what we looked at last week. We saw the miracle outside of the temple. Whenever you get into verses 12 through 26, as you finish up Acts chapter 3, Peter is now seizing the opportunity. Now, we know who Peter used to be. Before his encounter with Christ, before what happened there in the upper room on the day of Pentecost, Peter had denied Christ three times before Jesus' crucifixion. He was standing outside watching Jesus go through the mock trials that he was going through in the different areas of the courtyard that he was stationed at. He gathered around with people and they would say, "You are one of his followers. You have been following along with him. We've seen you." And he denied even knowing Jesus three times. We know that he was recommissioned by Jesus to go and to feed the sheep. And what we see here is that Peter is going to seize the opportunity to share the gospel, the heart of the Christian message, with a group, a crowd that is now gathered around, greatly wondering in what had happened to the lame man who had been sitting outside the beautiful gate for over 40 years. The challenge for us as Christians this morning is to make sure that we are prepared and equipped to be able to seize every opportunity that we have to share the gospel with those around us. Now, certainly, the crowd could have heard a testimony that day from the lame man of the healing that he had just received, but he wasn't discipled in being able to preach the gospel message yet. And Peter knew that's what the crowd needed to hear. Through the Holy Spirit and discernment from God, Peter understood that this group needed to hear the gospel. They needed to be presented an opportunity to repent from their sin. And so Peter begins his explanation of what is taking place in this miracle and what Christ could do for everyone in that crowd who would call upon the name of the Lord. And that's what our world needs to hear. That's what our society needs to hear today, is what Jesus can do for them if they will call upon the name of the Lord, if they will repent and turn to Christ. And so as we get into the first verses this morning, let's start out by reading verses 12 and 13 of Acts chapter 3. The Bible says, "And when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, 'You men of Israel, why marvel you at this? Or why look you so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man to walk? The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified his son Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go.'" Let's pray. Lord, we come to you this morning. We do thank you for another opportunity that we have to gather together this morning and just to praise your name, to glorify and magnify you for who you are and what you do in our life every day. And Lord, we pray that you would speak to our hearts once again through your message. We're thankful for the recorded words of Peter this morning that we can listen to and gain wisdom and knowledge and insight from. And we're thankful for the training that you gave him. And Lord, I pray that you would continue to impress upon us the need to be discipled and trained so that we can seize the opportunity to share your story, the gospel message, with those around us. And we pray all these things now in Jesus' name. Amen. As we know from leaving off last week in verse 11, the lame man is standing, he's holding on to Peter and John, and this crowd just swarms to where they're at. Peter sees this big group of people, and he could have very easily begun to brag upon himself, couldn't he? He could have said, "Do you see the miracle I just performed? Do you see that this man didn't have the strength in his feet and his ankles to be able to even stand up, but I made it possible for him to be able to stand in the wall?" But that's not what Peter does here. I mean, he could have added all kind of things onto it. He could have told them for a small fee, he would have touched a handkerchief and handed it to them, and they could be healed anytime they wanted to be, or anything that he could have thought of to do, he could have done that, right? But that's not what Peter does here. Peter saw this and he said, "Why do you marvel at this? Or why do you look so earnestly on us as though by our own power or holiness we made this man to walk?" Peter said, "I didn't do anything. I didn't have the power to heal him. I didn't have the authority to heal them. There is only one way that he experienced this, and that is through Christ." Jesus had allowed the miracle to take place. And Peter said, "You don't need to be marveling at me. You don't need to be looking at me, but I want to point you to the man who can truly heal you, that spiritually can transform your life, that spiritually can make such an impact and difference in your life that you will be able to do what I'm doing here today, and that is to boldly proclaim your faith and to share the gospel message." We must seize the opportunity to share the gospel message, to boldly proclaim our faith in the midst of a society that will persecute us, that will mock us, that will make fun of us, because they don't get it, and they don't understand it, and they think that the Bible is archaic, and it's outdated, and it's irrelevant, but it is still true today. It is still speaking to hearts today, and it can still deliver people from the bondage of sin today. There's power in the gospel message. There's power in the name of Jesus, and we must boldly be willing to share what Peter shares here in this message. He speaks of restoration. He speaks of Jesus' rejection, and he speaks of Jesus' resurrection in verses 12, 13, and in verses 15 and 16. He said there that the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified his son Jesus. Peter just gets right to the heart of the matter here. He said, "You need to understand what took place just a short time ago here in this city. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his son Jesus, whom you delivered up." Peter gets right into what took place, and he said, "You want to know why Jesus died upon the cross? You want to know why he was beaten, why he went through all the things that he went through? It's because you delivered him up and denied him in the presence of Pilate." Pilate was determined to let him go, he said, "But you delivered him up." Ultimately, anytime we think about the cross and the suffering that Jesus experienced before the cross and on the cross, we have to look in the mirror, don't we? Because it was us. It was our sin. It was my sin that nailed him to the cross. It was because of me and my brokenness and my sin that he had to suffer and die. It was determined by God that that was the only way, that Jesus would pay my debt, that he would be the perfect sacrifice, the spotless lamb, slain from the foundation of the world, so that you and I could experience eternal life, so that you and I could be forgiven, so that you and I could then seize the opportunity to share the gospel message with the world and equip others to share the gospel message with the world. It's why we emphasize Bible study. It's why we emphasize the Connect groups and Sunday school and Wednesday night activities and vacation Bible school. It's why we give money to the mission organizations so that there are others who can be equipped to go out and share the gospel and to continue to evangelize the world, fulfilling the Great Commission. He said, you denied the Holy One, verse 14, and the just, and desired a murderer to be granted unto you. The crowd that day cried out, crucify Jesus, give us Barabbas, release Barabbas. In verse 15, he said, you killed the Prince of Life, whom God hath raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. Peter very quickly, in his opening statement of this message, lets the crowd know that this man had experienced restoration. They could experience restoration. And it all came because the Gentiles had rejected Christ, the Jews had rejected Christ, and he was turned over to be crucified. But that wasn't the end of the story. Whenever he cried out, it is finished, and he gave up the ghost there on the cross and was placed in the borrowed tomb, that wasn't the end of the story, was it? It was a sad occasion. We know that there were women there who saw this. There were some of his followers there who saw this. They saw him wrapped up. They saw him placed in the borrowed tomb. And they were going to finish anointing the body after the Sabbath was over. They didn't know how they were going to roll the stone away. They didn't know any of that. They just knew that where he had been placed and how they needed to complete this project. And they walk, and whenever they get there, what did they see? The stone had been rolled away, and Jesus had walked out of that grave. He had walked out victoriously. And because he had walked out victoriously, he had defeated the grave, he had defeated sin, he had defeated death, and he had conquered Satan. He had stomped on his head and crushed him. Peter is letting them know that he had been resurrected, that he was alive. And he said, we saw him. We saw him. We ate breakfast with him on the beach. We saw him ascend into heaven. And if you have surrendered your life to Jesus, if you have experienced salvation this morning, then you are a witness of what Christ can do in your life. How he is still transforming you, how he is still molding you, how he is still shaping you into the individual that he would have you to be, how his Holy Spirit guides you into all truth and continues to speak to you through his word and can give you the same power, the same boldness to proclaim your faith the way that Peter did. We must simply seize the opportunity. And that leads to verses 17 through 26, where Peter gives an exhortation. He begins to plead with the people. He said in verse 16, his name through faith in his name had made this man strong. This man did not place his faith in Peter. He did not place his faith in John. He didn't place his faith in any of the other disciples. He placed his faith in Christ. Jesus is the sweetest name we know, the most powerful name we know, the most loving name we know. We could go through all of the descriptive words you could think of to talk about Jesus. He said, He has made this man strong, whom you see and know. He said, it's not like somebody that you've never met before and you didn't know is now standing here before you and can testify for what Christ has done in his life, but you know this man. You walk by him every day, coming through the beautiful gate, going into the temple multiple times a day. You've seen him. You know the condition he was in, but now he is here standing as a testimony to what Jesus can do for you. That's what Peter's telling him. He's a living testimony. Yea, the faith which is by him hath given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. So now we get the exhortation. We get the divine plea in verse 17. He said, here's why Israel rejected Jesus. He said, now, brethren, I walk without ignorance. Through ignorance you did, as did also your rulers. You thought that the Messiah was going to come and he was going to immediately destroy the Roman rule and authority over you, that he was going to seize control and become your earthly king. You were ignorant to the scriptures. You were ignorant to what the Old Testament had said. You weren't listening to the Old Testament prophets and really grasping hold of what they were trying to tell you. And out of ignorance, you had him crucified, as also did your rulers, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the religious leaders of the day. He said, but here's why you should receive Jesus, and here's how you can receive Christ. In verse 19, he said, repent ye therefore. Now I want you to understand, whenever Peter uses that word repent there, he is not trying, and anything up to this point, he is not trying to make the crowd feel bad. He is not trying to guilt them into salvation. When he gets here to verse 19 and he says, repent ye therefore, he is offering them hope. James Montgomery Boyce says that that word repent there should be seen as a word of hope, because God has made it possible for them to be able to repent. God provided a way for them to be able to repent. God has provided a way for you to be able to acknowledge that you are a sinner in need of a Savior, and that you can repent, you can turn to Christ, and you can experience forgiveness. And Peter seizes this opportunity, and without delay, he gets to the heart of the message here, and he offers them hope. He says, no matter what you've done, no matter how far you may have gotten off course, no matter how bad you think you are, you can repent. You can experience forgiveness. You can experience salvation. You can have a relationship with Jesus Christ. He goes on there and he says, be converted. The idea there is that you acknowledge your sin, you admit where you are, you turn to Christ, and you remain in him. He said that your sins may be blotted out. In that time period, in that part of the world, whenever they would write on a piece of paper or papyrus or whatever document and type of paper they were writing, the ink was different than the ink we use today. It didn't bite into the papyrus or whatever type of paper they were using at the time. And it could easily be wiped off the paper with a wet cloth. And so Peter is saying here, if you will repent, acknowledge who you are, acknowledge your need for a Savior, and beg forgiveness, then your sins can be blotted out. They can completely be wiped off the paper as if it was never there. When the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. There's hope given in this message. And Peter is telling the nation of Israel and the Gentiles as well who are standing there why they should receive Jesus. And he gives a divine program. He talks about the prophets in verses 22 through 25. He said, here's what the Old Testament fathers had to say. Here's how Jesus has already been testified of, already been talked about, how God put all of this in motion. He said, for Moses truly said unto the fathers in verse 22, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren. And he wasn't talking about Elijah. He wasn't talking about Elisha. He wasn't talking about Isaiah or Daniel or any of those prophets. He was talking about Jesus. He said, him shall you hear in all things, whatsoever he shall say unto you. And it shall come to pass that every soul which will not hear that prophet shall be destroyed from among the people. If you don't listen, Peter's saying, to the words of Jesus and the teachings of Jesus, which was what the apostles' doctrine was based on, and if you do not repent and be converted, then your sins will not be blotted out. They will be held to your account, and you will spend the eternity separated from the love of God forever in hell. God made it possible for you to experience salvation, to call upon the name of the Lord, to know Jesus as your Savior, so that you could experience forgiveness and have hope, joy, and peace in the midst of whatever it is that you may be facing in this world. It shall come to pass in verse 23 that every soul which will not hear the prophet shall be destroyed. And then in verse 24, yea, and all the prophets, from Samuel and those that follow after, as many as have spoken, have likewise foretold of these days. The Bible is real, it is true, it is accurate. The days are drawing near. We are one day closer today to Christ returning and rapturing the church than we were yesterday. And so we must seize every opportunity that we have to share the gospel so that the Spirit might work and move in that person's life and they might repent and experience forgiveness. He said, you, in verse 25, are the children of the prophets, and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying unto Abraham, and in thy seed shall all the kindreds of the earth be blessed. Jesus fulfilled that promise in the covenant of Abraham that was made by God. And there were many prophecies involved. That you could see it in Psalm 22. You could see it in Isaiah chapter 53. You could see it in Isaiah chapter 50 verse 6. All of these prophecies are mentioned in these verses in some way. In verse 18, he said, but those things which God before had showed by the mouth of all his prophets that Christ should suffer, he hath so fulfilled. You get to verses 20 and 21, he said, he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution of all things, which God had spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. In verse 26, he says, unto you, first God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from his iniquity. In these verses, Peter references Jesus' crucifixion and talks about his suffering. He once again talks about Jesus' resurrection. He talks about Jesus' present ministry and what he had done on earth for 3.5 years in his public ministry. And he also makes reference to Jesus' second coming. So the question that we need to ask ourselves this morning, are we seizing every opportunity that we have to share the gospel? Are we seizing every opportunity that we have to display God's love and his mercy and his grace to those around us? Are we seizing every opportunity to be the hands and the feet of Jesus to a world that needs to hear from him and to hear what his word says? And to let them know that that word repent is not a word of making them feel bad or guilting them into salvation, but we are offering them hope. We are offering them Jesus. We are offering them an opportunity to experience a relationship with Jesus Christ and know of their salvation, know of their eternal destination, and be able to experience something that this world cannot offer. We see this morning as we close out that Peter capitalized on the opportunity to share Jesus Christ. Displays of God's mercy and grace, such as the healing of the lame man in the first 11 verses, will create teachable moments. And that's what we're looking for every day, is teachable moments. Teachable moments for our children, teachable moments for our family, teachable moments for our neighbors, teachable moments with people we encounter at the grocery store or Dollar General or the gas station. We should pray to be bold and have courage like Peter, to see the opportunities, to seize the opportunities, and use every breath that we have to speak up for Christ. Let's pray. Lord, we